everyone, and welcome to another episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. I am Wade Price, delighted to be joined once more by the great Nick Bayton. How are you, Nick?
The great. Thank you. I'm very good, thank you, Wade. How are you doing, the mighty Wade Price?
Well, I am powerful. Thank you for inquiring. So we are going to take another venture into the Warhammer Underworlds today to inspect the latest warbands to be unleashed upon the Living Mountain, which is, of course, the Starblood Stalkers. Looking forward to this.
Yeah, absolutely, man. I absolutely love Warhammer Underworlds. It's one of my favorite games to play. And every time there's a new expansion to take a deep dive into, I really take a deep dive. So, yeah, I'm looking forward to this one a lot. They're much anticipated, this warband.
They really are, aren't they? Like, we've been to quite a few Warhammer Underworlds events together, like to commentate on Grand Clashes, and you've been to many, many more. So I'm sure you've been in touch with a number of people from the wider Warhammer Underworlds community. And I know people have been inquiring, when is there going to be a Seraph on warband? We've seen people kind of converting and kitbashing and doing counts as warbands with various Seraph on miniatures to get that itch scratched, to get some Seraph on miniatures on the table. But bespoke Seraph on warband, completely new miniatures. And you've had the opportunity to paint these already, haven't you?
You're absolutely right, Wade. So pretty much since the game was released from the Shadespire season one onwards, people are like, "Oh, I'd love to see Seraphon warband. I'd love to see some, you know, some lizards running around." It's been asked and asked and asked and asked constantly every season, and finally this season, their wish has been granted with this wonderful new Seraphon warband. You're absolutely right as well. We've seen people convert up. I've seen Steelheart's champions turn into Steelheart's Croxigore. I've seen Spike Claws swarm turned into Spike Claws skinks. Loads of really cool stuff out there in the community that people have done with Seraph models. They are much loved. One of the classic ranges of Games Workshop miniatures. And now we get to see them come to the Underworlds, which is exciting because not only are they quite a different warband, which we'll go through quite a lot soon, but I think, correct me if I'm wrong, but are they the first Warhammer Age of Sigmar specific sculpts we've seen of Seraphon miniatures?
I can't correct you off the top of my head. No, it's definitely been a while since we've seen anything. I think the Lizardmen Blood Bowl team has scratched a bit of an itch for Saurians. You've definitely made a lovely Warcry warband out of those miniatures. The similarity, of course, to what we see in the Seraphon range. The Realm Shaper engine, I guess, just the big piece of ziggurat with a monolith on the top of it. But that's not the same. That's not what you're asking. That's not the new Citadel miniature presentation. So what can you tell us is in the warband? What are the Starblood Stalkers and what are they comprised of?
Okay, so first of all, let's talk about like why they're in the Beastgrave Mountain. So the Starblood Stalkers are a hunting party of skinks. They've been sent out by the Slan Starmasters. Their leader, Kixi Taka, who is a skink priest, carries with him an ancient artifact, which, if activated at the right time, will destroy the mountain and all the Chaos Gods at the same, all the Chaos Forces there at the same time. The Slan Starmasters are worried that the Beastgrave Mountain itself is going to turn into an almost demigod of chaos at this point. So the skinks have been sent in, helped out as they are by Claptrock, the Saurus Old Blood, to try and stop the mountain becoming a demigod with his ancient artifact, which is quite cool, basically. So the Seraphon are there to save the world from chaos. That's pretty much their bag, isn't it?
It's noble, yeah.
It is. It is noble. So that's who they are. The warband itself consists of six miniatures, which I'm sure you guys have probably seen pictures of already. We've got Kixi Taka, the leader of the warband, who is the skink priest. We've got the Saurus Old Blood, Claptrock, who's there for a bit of muscle to back them up. Ota Patel, the first ever plastic chameleon skink, which is so cool. And then the three skink hunters to help them out as well. So quite a numerous warband with six miniatures.
Were you hoping maybe for just a Slan Starmaster and a little skink attendant to run around? I dropped the mountain on you.
Imagine that. That'd be great. Yeah, the Slan just opens up the world and you just fall into it and I win the game. Well, there's actually quite a lot of speculation about the Seraphon and how they would look when they would arrive eventually, because, you know, gamers all over the community were hoping that we'd see this faction added to Underworlds. And the speculation was like, oh, would it be like a really fighty warband with maybe like three or four Saurus? Could it be like a salamander and its skink handlers, or what could it be? And we've got it now. We've got a skink priest, his skink hunters, and a gigantic Saurus, which are all good fun.
Yep. And as we know from these sorts of discussions that we've had with the recent releases, we talked about Khagra's Ravagers and we talked about Diachasm and the new warbands when they first came out. Every warband is unique in Warhammer Underworlds. It's not a case of, this one is just a reskinned version of an existing warband and an existing mechanic. So I won't fall into the trap of saying, so what warbands are they like, but how would you describe them in the game? What's their style?
I think the Starblood Stalkers are going to play in a very interesting way. They're a very fast warband with quite a lot of miniatures, but they're not very high wounded miniatures, apart from Claptrochlosaurus Old Blood. So the Skinks are going to be running around super fast, nipping all over the place, grabbing objectives, and then getting away again from the opponents and trying as hard as they can to stay away from being locked in combat with aggressive warbands, and at the same time nipping all over the place, capturing objectives and scoring the glory that way. In a way, the warband is similar to the Eyes of the Nine, because there's lots of different elements of the warband that are all acting. You've got the Skink Priest doing his thing, you've got the Skinks, the Communion Skink, and of course the Saurus Old Blood. But at the same time, they're going to play a lot like Hrothgar's Mantraps and Khagra's Ravagers, both of whom are concentrating quite heavily on destroying objectives and stopping people scoring objective tokens. I think probably the most similar Spike Claw Swarm as well, lots of high wounded miniatures that are very fast moving. It's going to be a tough warband to use. It will take you a few tries to get it right, I think. But I think once you get it right and you get the right cards in your deck, they're going to be super powerful.
And yeah, even acknowledging that every warband is unique, I just wanted to make sure that I wasn't exposed to any sort of gotcha when you told me that every warband was unique. But it's entirely fair to consider them in terms of the existing warbands. And it's an interesting dimension that you have to consider so much that goes into what a warband is in the game. It's not just the composition and the miniatures and the details on the fighter cards and how they inspire and also how they gain glory and win objectives. There's an awful lot to it. So you can't just look at one warband and say it's like them, because there'll be lots of existing elements fused together in a new way, but also maybe introduce new elements to the game. And that's another feature of every warband, that it's brought in a new challenge for every existing player with whatever setup or deck they have, or whatever plan they think they might have. This new warband might be there to ruin it.
Yeah, definitely. It's going to be really interesting seeing people play against these for the first time.
Mm. Cool. So please take us through the warband. Introduce us to the fighters.
Let's say hello to all the fighters then. So first up, the leader of the warband is Kixi Taka the Diviner, who's been sent in by the Slan Star Masters to destroy the mountain with his artifact. He's the leader of your warband. Now, he's a Skink Priest, but interestingly enough, he's not actually a wizard in terms of the game itself, which I think, Wade, represents the fact that the Slan Star Masters kind of use their powers through him rather than him using powers himself. Does that make sense?
I think so, yeah. That's a really interesting wrinkle, isn't it? Like the presence of the wizard, kind of as you say, the influence of the Slan Star Master, who's not in the Beast Grave, as we've discussed already, but to be able to introduce some of the features that we associate with wizards without actually being one themselves. Interesting.
So he's quite small. He's only got 3 wounds, which for a leader character is tough. It's one of the lowest wounded leaders in the game. But he has got 2 dodge defense, so he's quite good at dodging attacks, but at the same time, only 3 wounds. He's got long-range attacks with a 2-range Staff attack, which is quite Starstone Staff, that's easy for you to say, which does 2 damage, and his Starbolt attack as well, which is like a ranged attack, very similar to a magical ranged attack, but it's actually just using attack dice, which does only 1 damage. So he's not a wizard himself. That's it. That's me. When he inspires, he gets +1 dice on the Starbolt, remains at damage 1. He is not a killer. He's not there to kill stuff. But he is there to use his ancient artifacts, which we will come to later on and see how that works.
Double check both sides of the card a few times just to see, does he get anything when he inspires? But yeah, as you said, that extra dice with the Starbolt. But as
it
He's got a role within the warband, but it's definitely not to go up.
It's definitely not killing stuff. So you're not going to be scoring Victorious Duel too much with this warband, which is killing another leader with your leader. But he definitely will be scoring you lots of glory in other ways.
Who do you have to hit things with then?
Up next, Wade, you've got Claptroch, the Saurus Old Blood. What a miniature this is. Such a gorgeous, gorgeous toy soldier. He is, imagine him to be like your Oberon the Bold or the Kacharik kind of character. He's the big hitter, right? He hits stuff on the head with his big mace and they die lots. So it's nice to have some muscle in the warband so you can do some killing as well. He's quite slow, though. It's only movement 3, got 1 shield defense and 4 wounds. So he's a standard fighter stats for a character like this. He's very much similar to the Stormcast Eternals. And his Celestite Warmall hits big with 3 damage. He also has a really cool secondary attack, much like Ripper's Snarlfangs do. He's got powerful jaws, which he can use as a free reaction after any activation, not just attacks. So the card simply says, after any activation, use this attack, which means you can move him and attack with the powerful jaws as a move action, or you can put him on guard and attack with the powerful jaws if you wanted to, I think. So that's pretty cool, isn't it? But also it means obviously he can run in, hit you on the head with his big maul for 3 damage, and then bite you with his jaws for a potential 4th damage, which is quite cool. And when he inspires, which he does if he gets any successful attack action, which is because he's got lots of attack actions options to go for, is quite likely. He gets +1 move to move 4, +1 defense, so he's on 2 shields, and +1 dice on the powerful jaws as well to make it more accurate, which is great. So he's a big, powerful fighter, and I imagine, Wade, much like Kacharik is in the Eyes of the Nine, he'll probably be the target of your enemy's attacks quite early on in the game.
That seems reasonable, but that will keep your squishier skinks a little bit more protected for the damage to come. So does that mean you can use the powerful jaws reaction to inspire? Does that count as a successful attack action?
It does indeed. Yeah, let's have a look at the card here. It says, after this fighter's activation, this fighter makes the powerful jaws attack action. And if it makes a successful action, attack action, he inspires. So you could literally move with him onto anywhere at all. As long as there's an enemy within one range, you then make that attack action. And if that's successful, you inspire, which is quite... It's only one fury, so it's not that... it's like a 33% chance of scoring it. But it's still worth a try.
It's another great kind of floating threat in the Beast Grave with the prevalence of lethal hexes and just the number of things around the arena that could just inflict that extra point of damage that could be enough to take a fighter out of action. It's just another wrinkle for players to consider in their own fighters.
The magical damage you can try and get to in Warhammer Underworlds, if you can get to a damage 4 fighter doing damage 4, that's great, because there's so many warbands out there. Think like the Worm Spat, think of all the Stormcast Eternals, think of all the Magors Fiends. All the warbands have got big, tough 4-wound fighters. If you can get your fighters to damage 4, then you're laughing, because and he's doing it with 3 basic damage on his big war maul and then 1 extra on the bite. You could do a damage 4 fighter in one hit, which is great.
Yeah, absolutely. And then pushes his move and defense up to make him a little bit more durable and maneuverable for the fights to come. Excellent. And now onto the skinks. What can you tell us about Otterpattle?
He's my favorite model in the warband. I think that's fair to say. The Otterpattle with Chameleon Skink is a very interesting miniature. He is both a hunter and a quarry, which is interesting. So lots of different cards in the game work off those two keywords. He's only got 2 wounds, but he has got 2 dodge defense, which quite nice. Pardon me. He's movement 4 to start with, and his dart pipe is his weapon that he uses. It's range 3 dice, but only hits on a crit, which is it's pretty good. It's the first weapon I can think of in the game that only ever hits on a crit. But it gives an enemy model a move token if it's successful, which is amazing. So you've got a 42.13% chance of putting a movement token. That's my working out the dice. If you roll 3 dice, try and get 1 crit, it's a 42% chance, apparently, of putting a movement token on a fighter and stopping them charging. So he's not there to sort of kill stuff. He's there to sort of go poof, and just you know your most powerful miniature that's over there was about to charge in. Now he's got a move token and can't. In my mind, I'm like, imagine if you're using Molog. Molog the Mighty Troll, he's not been wounded yet, so he's not inspired. So you just go and put a movement token on him. Molog's not moving anymore, which is, I imagine, for many fighters in the game, that'd be quite upsetting. Same for Fjeldred Grimnir or Morgulk or any of the big fighters in the game, or Magor, that need to get in there and do hitting. He's the guy that's going to shut that down. So you can see straight away, we're already talking about control in the warband and controlling your opponent's models and stopping them moving around, which is going to be a big thing.
Stopping them playing their game while you get your sword into position to bite them, smash them. Great stuff.
When he inspires Otterpattle, he goes to +1 move to move 5, +1 defense. So he's 3 defense dice on a skin. That's crazy cool. He's on dodges, but it's still a pretty good chance of getting a success. And his dart pipe goes to damage 2, which is great. So actually, he can start actually hitting people and hurting people. So I love that model. I think it's fantastic. He'll be a real irritation of your opponent.
But you reckon Clacktrock is still going to be the primary target or the target of most opportunity?
If you can hit Otapattle early, you will get rid of him immediately. But I think Claptrot's going to be all up in your face early and stopping you doing that. He'll be the distraction while Otapattle comes around and stops your big models moving. Smart reckon.
Meanwhile, there are three skink hunters running around harrying at you as well. And they're all individually armed and equipped, aren't they?
Yeah, they are. It's quite cool, actually. So they're not all just identical. It's nice. They're all hunters. They have the hunter ability. This is Huachi, Tok, and Zepic or Chepic. They have... they're all tier wounds, again, pretty squishy. Huachi's got... they're all movement four as well, so quite fast. There's one with a javelin, Huachi, who's... he can poke with the javelin for a two damage attack, which is quite cool. Or he can throw it for a range three one damage attack, and something's interesting to say is that he hasn't got the restriction that there's Jagathra from the Godsworn Hunt has a javelin as well. When she throws it, she loses it, but this is a meteoric javelin, so it comes back to him when he throws it, so it comes back to his hand, which is quite cool. So he's not restricted on how many times he can use it. That's pretty cool. Tok has he's got a blowpipe called Bolt Splitter, which is quite cool, and a Moonstone Club too. So he's got some range attack and some combat attack. It's not powerful, but they're he's quite cool for just running around. He gets a plus one dice, plus one movement, plus one defense when he inspires as well, which is great. And Chepic or Zepic, I don't know how it's pronounced, but I'm going to go Zepic. Is quite cool too. He's got a Moonstone Club, which goes up to damage two when he inspires, which is nice. They've all got different things when they inspire, but crucially, they all get super fast when they inspire as well. So you've got movement five skinks when they inspire, which is great.
It's ludicrous. They all have skittish on Huachi. Has skittish card as well as a reaction that those skinks all have.
They do indeed, yeah. So skittish is a special rule for this warband only, which appears on all of the skink hunters I've just mentioned. So it's on Huachi, Tok, and Zepic. It's a really cool little reaction that after your opponent's power step, push this fighter one hex away from enemy fighters within two hexes. So in theory, you can do this potentially four times in a round because your opponent will have four power steps. Okay, so it's super good against enemy models trying to close in on you. So if a model comes towards you and tries to get near you, they end up two hexes away from you, and you're still alive at the end of their power step. Well, you can push your model a hex away from that miniature, which is quite cool. So crucially, though, this is after an activation. Am I getting this wrong? I was making sure I'm getting skittish right on the card. After opponent's power step. Yeah, this is after a power step, not an activation. Activation is when you move the miniature around. Power step comes after that. But you can also move multiple skinks with it. So if one model comes within two of your skinks, within two hexes of two of your skinks, after their power step, you can move both of those skinks away, which is quite cool. So basically, it's a way of keeping them at arm's length, which is great. My top tip here is why not push, use a push enemy ploy, right? Think about this. It's like a card like Nightmare in the Shadows or Distraction, and push one of your enemies towards you one hex. So he's all of a sudden within two hexes of two of your skinks. Then you get to move two of your skinks, right? So basically you can turn that move enemy card into move two of your own guys card, which is much more valuable. That's very cool. And also say, I reckon as well, Skittish is going to be quite useful for running onto an objective that's within two X's of an enemy fighter. Your warband inspires immediately because that's their inspiration condition, which is after an activation, your warband holds three or more objectives. But imagine running onto an objective, inspiring, and then using Skittish to move away from the guy that's right next to them as well. So pretty tasty. It's a good way of keeping them over there and not fighting you so much. They're going to have to move to get to you rather than just getting free attacks, which I quite like.
So when they get up to potentially movement five, if they're inspired, and also the opportunity to add in the capacity for a few extra squares of movement if placement works just right. Yeah, if you've got everything aligned in line with the old ones' constellations, you can have a fine plan worked out with this warband and really confound your opponent, because I'd like to play warbands. I like to hit things, you know. I like to hit things in my Warhammer games. So this is going to be infuriating for the warbands that really just want to get their hands on the opposition. Not only can you not get your hands on them, they're also scoring objectives.
At the same time, though, if you get your hands on them, they're only small. They're only two wounds. They've not got that many defense dice, most of them. So they should be quite easy to kill. Even the leader, if you get anywhere near the leader, good luck with that. Then you'll kill him dead in one hit, probably. But it's going to be a real toughie getting there.
So the skinks will become inspired once the warband holds three or more objectives, which probably...
Yeah, so the entire warband does. The entire warband becomes inspired when if you hold three or more objectives, apart from Claptrog, the Saurus Old Blood, who inspires if he makes a successful attack action. So if you can hold three objectives after an activation, so crucially, that's before a power step kicks in, so before your opponent has a chance to move you off of the objectives with push cards, if you hold three objectives at any one time, you inspire the warband. Which is quite cool, but not every model gets loads out of inspiration, but they can be quite important for the movement, I reckon.
You've ranked them, I see. You've put some notes together and see who benefits the most from being inspired. Yeah. So you've already got this worked out. You're putting together this plan.
I know, right? I've even used maths and everything. But so, okay, we'll go in my top six who benefits the most from inspiration. Arguably the least benefiting from inspiration is the leader himself, Kixi Taka, who only gets plus one dice on the Starbolt range attack, taking it from a 70.3% chance of success to an 87.5% chance of success. I'm so sorry. I use a calculator and everything. He doesn't get any movement, no defense, no extra damage, so he's there for your support character. He's like, inspiring him is quite cool. Hoachi gets plus one move, and Hull Javelin gets plus one dice and knockback, which is nice. He's in at number five. Zepic, his Moonstone Club, gets plus one dice and plus one damage and plus one move as well. All the skinks get plus one move, apart from the leader. Toxin at three, who's quite good. He gets plus one move, plus one defense, plus one dice as one club as well. Claptrophosaurus is at number two. He's got plus one move, plus one defense, and the jaws get plus one dice. So go and hit stuff real hard with him once he inspires. Mm-hmm. And also, he might inspire earlier on because he doesn't have to wait for the three objectives. But Otapathel, the Communist Skink, is my king of inspiration in this warband. If you can get warband inspired, he's going to benefit the most. His defense dice goes up to three defense dice, which is, as we mentioned, crazy. And the Dark Pipe going to damage two, as well as plus one movement. So he gets fast, more damagey, and more defensive when he gets inspired. So there we go. But it's important for most of the warband. I think the real boon for the warband is going to be the movement characteristic, as five out of the six fighters get a movement boost when they inspire, which is quite cool.
So, yeah, it's good stuff to know, to consider once the warband becomes inspired, which might be a two-step process. You might manage to get it to take place around the same time, and then to know who you might still want in your warband if you do have to consider sacrificing anybody for the greater good, who you might still have and what might you want to be able to do with them. Great stuff. So what is truly unique about this warband? What is a unique feature that has been introduced? You mentioned it before, the artifact.
That's the artifact, which I don't think gets named. I've looked. I don't think it's named. It's got a sacred artifact, the leader, Kixi Taka. It's designed to consume the land around him, which is, you know, the mountain's designed to consume itself, and it reflects that. Check this out. He's got an action on his card, which says, pick one feature token within three hexes. So that's going to be a lethal hex token or an objective token. Flip that feature token or deal one damage to enemy fighter within one hex of that token. This fighter can only make this action once per round. So the last section there means you can only do this three times in the game at a maximum, because there are three rounds in the game. But crucially, it means you don't get a move token or a charge token once you do it. So once he's done this, he can do other stuff as well. Or he can move and do this. He can't charge and do this because you can't activate a fire truck if you've done this, but you can move, then do this in another activation, which is great. In theory, you could easily destroy three objective tokens on the board with no rolling. And that means that other cards in the game where you need to draw the right ploy, or maybe you had to do something with desolation tokens to do the same sort of thing to shut down objectives, but not for these guys. They literally just, he just points an objective token and it flips as long as it's three hexes away. Downside being here, Wade, that you had to get within three hexes of the objective token, which might bring you within three nearer to the enemy miniatures, but it's a price you're going to have to pay, and we'll come how he deals with that later on. Okay. Which is quite cool, isn't it? Like, the fact you can just like shut down objectives like that is great.
Absolutely. And again, another something else for your opponents to consider while they're trying to get them out to their own game, just the looming threat of, well, that could happen if the stars align. That could really rob you of your opportunity to play the game if you were objective-minded yourself.
I think it's also quite nice as well. You mentioned earlier on, Wade, that in this kind of game, that just doing one cheeky bit of damage here or there can actually make a big difference to the game. And you're right. If his action is, you see that fighter stood on an objective over there, he takes the damage and that kills him. that can be highly irritating.
Lethal hexes, and you'd taken care to make sure you weren't going to be pushed into the lethal hex, but all of a sudden, it's not a case of being pushed, the lethal hex comes to you, it inflicts an extra bit of damage, an extra bit of range. Yeah, just more wrinkles being added to the Warhammer Underworlds game, and more things to consider as you go in there yourself. Good stuff.
In my mind, this one, Wade, you need to be quite savvy about where you place, because you have to place a lethal hex at the start of the game. If you can be quite savvy about where you place it, place that lethal hex next to, if you can, a lethal hex. I'm not sure you can, but if you can place it next to a lethal hex, do it, because that means you can just let them take a damage off and then use a push card to drive them in. I'll have to check to see if you can place one next to it, but if you can, that's what you need to do. Okay.
And how do you imagine skittish is going to be employed as a tactic? That's another unique feature of this warband.
It's so good. It's such a good thing. Like I said before, man, two things you can you can have enemies come towards you to try and claim objectives. So you might put your warband two hexes away from the objective they're trying to capture. So they go and stand on it. You get to move your guys for free, which is quite nice. I think that moving up, capturing an objective, holding it, scoring glory for that, and then moving away from the objective because it's within two hexes of an opponent is going to be really nice. It's a great little thing. Now, admittedly, if you're within two hexes of an opponent and you only move one hex away, then you're only three hexes away. It's not that far, and most models will be able to hit you, but it puts you out of range of all the range two attacks, and it might help you put you out of range of other charges from other miniatures in the warband as well, which would be quite useful.
And what can you tell us of asterisms?
I'll look to the stars and tell you. The asterism is another thing that makes these guys quite unique. There's a unique set of ploys. There's three of them: the Bulwark Celestial, the Great Drake, and the Hunter's Steed. All Gambit ploys that are faction specific to the Starblood Stalkers, they are named asterism as the type of card. They're very similar to the Worm Spat Cycle cards. If you play one of them, it stays in play until the end of the round, or until you play another asterism card. They're quite cool actually, and offer you bonuses to your entire warband. So stuff like plus one move, plus one dice to all range one attacks, and that sort of thing. They're really good, and definitely probably something you want to be looking at, taking one, at least two of them for your warband if you can. So again, it's quite a cool set of ploys.
That is another concern of the opposition, trying to establish the threat range of the skinks in that warband, just trying to consider what could they possibly move. Well, could be something absolutely ludicrous. You're probably not safe anywhere on the battlefield. That's probably the best way to
I mean, when you say not safe, it's not as if they're going to come with a giant weapon, but they are. They can go anywhere at all. Don't think any space on the battlefield is safe.
I've been painting some Skaven recently. My consideration of what is threatening has been reduced a little bit from my
blood pain presentation. So, Skaven clan rat, a Ravenous Skink is probably quite threatening.
Good times. So in Warhammer Underworlds gaming parlance, what kind of warband would you define the Starblood Stalkers as?
Yeah, we've defined there's four different types of warband in the game of Warhammer Underworlds. The first one, which is close to yours and my heart, Wade, is the aggro warband, which just goes and hits stuff on the head with a big axe, right? You're a fan of that.
I am, yeah. hit it harder.
You've got other warbands who are quite good at their holding objective is the second one, where their whole shtick is to get the objective tokens on the battlefield, hold them, and get glory points for doing that. The third type of warband is the control warband, which is basically just stops the opponent doing what they want to do. They just shut the opponent down and score a little bit of glory here and there, but hopefully that means they're going to win the game. And the fourth type is a flex, which is basically one of the other three types mixed with another one of the other three types. So, if, for example, you have aggro control warbands, and this warband in particular is, from what I've read so far, I think I'm going to safely say is a flex, hold objective, and control warband. You are trying to control the objectives on the board, stopping your opponent scoring them, and at the same time holding them away from you so they can't get their aggro in and hit you on the head with a big stick, but also scoring points from objectives as well. What I think you're looking to do here is to score points from holding objectives early on, and then stop the opponents scoring their objectives later on in the game by either just keeping them away, or better still, actually destroying the objective token so they can't score them anymore.
That is indeed why the Slam Masters have sent them in with that artifact. That's what it's for. It's not just for show. It can be used to destroy our objectives. So how do the Starblood Stalkers go about gaining glory themselves?
Well, man, so let's have a look at some of the cards in the game. And I've got some notes here about some stuff I've written of the various cards that come in the expansion. And we'll start off by looking at the objective cards that are faction-specific to the Starblood Stalkers. That means that only these guys can take them. And as you might imagine, they're off there because they're faction-specific to this warband. They are very much closely designed with how that warband's supposed to work. So let's have a look. Astromatics Alignment is a great card. Score one glory for flipping any feature token in enemy territory. Great. That's a wonderful card. Easy to do. You're probably going to do that with ease. And remember, enemy territory includes one hex away from no man's land, so you can probably do that in the first turn. Great. Place one objective and one hex away from no man's land, and you'll score that quite easily, probably, if you can draw it early on. Balance the Cosmic Equation is a hybrid card. Score if two or more enemy fighters are out of action, or you hold more objectives than the enemy. And things are going to be looking to destroy their objectives and stand up doors. Perfect. Right? That's
irritating. The divine plan. Yeah, you can definitely see how the artifact is going to be useful in this. Well, you could use the artifact, yep. Astromatics Alignment. Of course, once you've used the artifact, you stand a greater chance of holding more objectives than your opponent.
That's exactly right. This will be a running theme as well. Formidable Focus, which also is one of the faction-specific cards. Surge is a score immediately if three friendly fighters are in enemy territory, and they're so easy to do when you've got super fast skinks.
Yep.
Great. You can score that almost immediately. The downside being you have to be in enemy territory, which is where all their fighters are, which is, if they're going to be hitting on the head of sticks, might be a problem. Instinctive Tactics is a wonderful card as well. Surge, score for resolving second reaction in the same phase. Now, we talked about Skittish earlier on and Claptrox Powerful Jaws. They're both reactions. So if you can use Skittish twice in a phase, which is four activations, great. You've scored. You score one glory. It's going to happen. And you can actually design it to happen as well by moving your guys towards the enemy models and doing that.
Yeah.
I'd say that.
Definitely. Sounds like something, again, you want to be doing most of this to make the best use of some of the abilities that your fighters have, unique abilities for your unique fighters. So, yeah, rewarded for what they're good for.
All of those so far are only one glory, so you're not going to win the game with those, but they are quite tasty. Seeking the Heart is quite a nice card. It's a hybrid card, which means you have to do... one of two things. Each surviving friendly fighter is an enemy territory, which is hard, or your warband holds each objective in enemy territory. Now that's interesting to do because you can simply reduce the numbers of objectives in their territory, and if there's only one objective in their enemy territory and you hold it, you score two glory in the end phase. Great. And Will of the Slan, which is cool. In the end phase, score if your warband holds one or more objectives in two or more players' territories. For two glory, I've said another auto take here. There's also a card called Swift Capture, which is not from this expansion, but it's from the wider game, which does the same kind of thing for one. But if you can just hold one in your objective and the only one you've left in their territory, great. Glory. Two glory, too. And there's a card in the deck which I love called The Great Plan, which is exactly how the Slan kind of play. It's a duel, which means you've got to do multiple things to score it, but it is worth three glory, which is game-changing. And to do this, you've got to score in an end phase if throughout the entire game you've already scored one Surge, one Hybrid, and one Duel objective. So you have to make sure those are in your objective deck. But if you can do all of those throughout the game and then draw this, then you will score three glory, which is fantastic if you draw it later on in the game. If you draw it in your opening hand, that's irritating because you're going to have to keep it in your hand or discard it.
Absolutely. But otherwise, you can definitely see that broad ambition of, well, if I reduce the number of objectives in enemy territory to reduce the number of my friendly fighters I need to get in there while still having some objectives in my own territory. Yeah, interesting.
Which is why it's quite tricky, isn't it? It's not easy. It's not an easy go and hit them on the head with an axe. You've got to really think about how you're going to do this. And also, many players in the Warhammer Underworlds game will know you're trying to do this and will probably try and counteract it. So it's going to be interesting playing.
So beyond the new cards in the expansion, what other existing cards or objectives do you think might help them?
There's one other universal card in the expansion, which is fantastic for these guys. Every expansion comes with a number of universal cards that every warband in the game can use. And there's one in here called The Greater Hunt, which is amazing. A score in the end phase. If you have more friendly hunters than enemy hunters, you score a glory point. Wow. you start with four hunters in the warband, which is Otapathel and the three hunter skings. So I don't think there is any warband in the game. I can't think of one that's got more than that. Rippers and Nalfangers have got three. Other warbands have got one or two. So if you can score that, and obviously you have a chance to make Claptrock and Kicked Attacker hunters too with the various upgrades and things. So keep have all your models alive, getting a glory point, basically. Wonderful. I would take that. That's an easy glory to get. Let's have a look at some of the cards from the wider game as well. So these aren't cards that are coming from this expansion, but overall in the overall game, so this will be the entire Beast Grave and Dire Chasm sets as well, all the universal cards. You've got Hidden Purpose and Temporary Victory. Designed, if you hold two or three objectives, you go and gain one or two glory immediately. So if you just run two skinks onto two objectives with their movement massive, or three objectives, you score one or two glory for each one of those cards. You might be looking to try and hold three objectives at once. I'd be looking to put three objectives in my own territory if I could for this, and having minimal objectives in the opponent's territory for all the different things you're trying to score. If you can hold all three in your zone, then you're going to score temporary victory and inspire winner. That's quite tricky, isn't it? It's tough to do, though. Ahead of the hunt, score an end phase if there is one surviving friendly quarry for one glory. Now, quarry is a keyword on cards, and Otapathel, the chameleon skink, is a quarry. So if he's alive in an end phase, you score ahead of the hunt, and you're looking to keep him alive as best as possible because he's dead useful. There's a massive card, Wade, called Feed the Beast Grave, which is a huge five glory score, but score an end phase if there are no objective tokens on the battlefield. Now, it's tough, right? But it is possible. In theory, if you're looking to score this card, this might be the one you look to score to win you the game. You can destroy three with Kicked Attacker's artifacts, and then you can score other ones with various upgrades and ploys and things. Now, it's a big shout, and it's going to be tough to score your other objectives if you've started destroying them early on, but it's five glory, man. I've never seen anyone score it, so it's possible. Up next, I've got Treasure Hunter, which is a great card. Score an end phase if you hold two objectives in enemy territory, but it's worth three glory, right? Totally risky, but could be worth it. Get your skinks in there nice and quick. Dominant Position, score an end phase if you hold more objectives than other warbands. For two glory, you've got to hold one objective, and the enemy has none, to score two glory. Yes, please, auto-take that one. Coveted Spoils, score an end phase if all objectives are held. Three glory. Big glory here for reducing the number of tokens on the table. You can basically, if you just reduce the objectives down to like two or three objective tokens left on the board, and you score all of them, it's three glory. Brilliant. So you can see here.
An abiding feature. Like if a lot of people are assuming there will be a fixed number, the regular number of objectives on the battlefield to play, that's a kind of consistent feature. But if all of a sudden somebody's got the ability to halve that number and displace where they are, that will completely ruin people's games.
And more so than any other warband so far we've seen Hrothgon's Mantrappers, who can sort of take away some objective tokens and flip them around. And of course you've got the desecration tokens from Kakros Ravagers, but not these guys can just like get rid of those objective tokens. They are literally destroying the Beastgrave Mountains like the Slan told them to. Next up, cards, we've got Guardians of the Way, another universal objective card. Score an end phase if a warband holds one objective and the enemy holds none. Yep, I'll do that for one glory, no probs. Uncontested is an objective card, a dual card, so you've got to both hold two objectives and an enemy holds none for three glory. Three, that's a massive score. You hold two, they have none. Great. Combine this with putting lots of push cards in your deck, Nightmare in the Shadows, Distraction, other cards that move the enemy around, and also cards that destroy objectives they're stood on, then you're going to score this really easily. Master of Hazards, Surge is score if you flip two feature tokens in a turn. So that's easily doable. If you have that in your hand and you've got some of the ploys that flip a feature token and you've got Kicked Attacker still alive, you're in. And Change of Fortunes, score immediately if you flip a feature token that contains a friendly fighter for a glory. Great. So Kicked Attacker goes and stands on an objective and he flips it. Done. That's a glory. Cover Ground, there's a surge where you move six spaces in a move for a glory. Well, that's easy to do, isn't it? Any inspired skink with any movement upgrade, great speed, or any of the movement upgrades we'll talk about later on, you're moving six spaces for a glory. That's nice and cheeky. And one last one as well, which I loved, which is absolute stillness. Score an end phase if a quarry is holding an objective and has no tokens, no movement tokens or charge tokens to glory. Combine this with Invisible Hunter, which is a ploy we'll see later on, and you can just put him on an objective token anywhere anywhere on the entire board, because he just disappears and then reappears for two glory, which is great. So that's a card I'd take for. So lots of different ways I reckon they can score glory, but you can definitely see a running theme there, can't you?
Absolutely, yeah, and it does definitely seem to be playing into the idea of, well, we can just turn off more objectives than other warbands can, and if your entire game is either based around capturing objectives or hitting the opposition, it sounds like the Starblood Stalkers have ways of confounding you and turning that off. And this is just talking about inspiration. We haven't even got into the upgrades and how else you can boost some of the features. If there are things that appeal in different ways to people who might want to play with this warband, there are other ways to further tweak and refine them.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? You've obviously got cards that do big hitting. So you've got like Claptrotosaurus, who is actually quite good at dealing damage. And we've also got one of the skinks, who does two damage on his weapon. So that you can do some hitting. It's not like you're completely helpless. You can kill stuff, but you're definitely not looking to get everyone in combat if you can possibly avoid it. So it's going to be an interesting, different way of playing, isn't it, I suppose?
So we've just looked at them with the benefits potentially of inspiration. We haven't even looked at the other cards in the new expansion. What can you tell us of their gambit ploys?
Gambit ploys. Right. There's two different types of power cards in the game for your power decks: gambit ploys and upgrades. And let's have a look at the gambit bug and magic. But there's no wizards in this warband, so we're not going to look at magic. But let's have a look at the gambit ploys first of all. Okay, there's a few that are really, really good. Again, the faction specific ones are again designed around the way that they play the game. So let's have a look at the faction specific gambit ploys for these guys. Burst in the shadows. Choose up to two friendly hunters. Remember, that's Otapackle or any of the three skinks, and push them two hexes. Wow, what a card. Most of the time you get to choose one model and push it one hex. This card, you choose two models and push them two hexes. Yes, absolutely. And it doesn't have to be away from a model either. It has to just be push them anywhere at all, which is great.
Just extra movement. Brilliant.
Can't go wrong with extra movement, and that's again going to be something we'll be seeing quite a lot of here. Huanchi's Device is another great card. Either push one enemy fighter one hex, or your enemy pushes three fighters one hex. So you can say to your enemy, you choose three fighters, push them one hex, which might be useful for scoring certain objectives. Most of the time, you'll be choosing an enemy fighter and pushing them one hex into a lethal objective, or maybe off an objective token, or maybe even towards your skinks, so you can push them using skittish, which is quite cool to do. Up next, I've got Invisible Hunter. This is a wonderful card. This is for Otapattle, the chameleon skink, so he disappears. Remove Otapattle from the board. He comes back at the end of the round, which basically means after all four activations, okay, in an empty hex not adjacent to enemy fighters. So I've got use this bad boy to capture enemy territory objectives and score absolute stillness. So you take him off the board, just disappears for a few activations and comes back somewhere else, anywhere, an empty hex, which it can be an objective token, which is just great.
Is there anything else in the game currently have the opportunity to do that?
We've had stuff like the Blue Horror for Eyes of the Nine, which can just appear. We have certain cards, I believe in the Skaven, where they can just run off and come back elsewhere. We have other cards, the Faneway Crystal, let you do that sort of thing before it got rotated out of the game. I can't think of anything that just disappears off the board and comes back later on. I'm sure there are. I'm sure I've forgotten about something, so someone out there will tell me. But yeah, it's pretty powerful. But also, crucially, not only does it move him all the way where you want him to be, it means that you can't touch him. He doesn't sort of like go and stand there and you can go and hit him. You take him off the board. He's not dead, crucially, for all the different cards that say that he might be. But then he just put him back at the end of the round. That's great. So you can't touch him. You can't hurt him. He just appears anywhere he likes on any empty hex. I'm just going to read that to make sure it's right, which is just wonderful card. Really, really good card. So take that one. And it'll really irritate your opponent. And also, it's the kind of card where that if your opponent knows you've got it in your deck somewhere, they have to deal with it. And they know that Otapattle could be going anywhere. I've got another card.
I assume it'll come up at the wrong time for them, but playing, you have to kind of play assuming it'll never come up at the right time for you. Just lurking there as a threat.
Absolutely. And there's other things you could do with them as well. You could put him on a hex to mean that Claptrop gets supporting fighters. You could put him on an objective token, because you can put the last objective token on an edge, so he could be on an edge hex to score other objectives as well. Loads of things you could do with that card. It's super useful. Up next, I've got Light of the Stars. Play this gambit to prevent all damage from an opposing gambit. So one of the ways that your opponents will be looking to kill the enemy, your leader, Kixi Taka, is by zapping him with indirect damage gambits that sort of say do one damage straight away without even rolling for it. And you can use this to prevent all damage from a gambit, which is great. So it just helps Kixi Taka be a bit more resilient. You've got Lords of Space and Time, which... it's got to be the name of the Seraphon band, isn't it? Choose one friendly fighter not adjacent to enemy fighters. So one friendly fighter not adjacent to enemy fighters. Place that fighter in same hex as an objective token in enemy territory and not adjacent to enemy fighters. And you give this model a move token. Wow. So pick up one of your friendly fighters and move it to any objective token in enemy territory. You can see from all we've talked about so far, that is a super powerful ploy. You get a movement token. Who cares? You do that in the last power step of the game, of a round, sorry, and that will help you both inspire your warband if they're not already inspired, and score temporary victory, all the other cards that you want to be scoring as well. That is a great card.
There's a running theme through these cards where you can move quite a few of your models without needing to refer to their move characteristic at all. Yep. It's just all in the card at that point, not in the fighter card at all.
All the slam doing your sort of wibbly slam things, isn't it? That's how it works. I quite like it. It's nice how they put the real narrative of the Seraphim in. We've got a card called Sotex Poison. I imagine some sort of frog has been scraped all over their weapons or something. It's a reaction. Play during a friendly fighter's attack to give target a move token. Great! We're slowing down the enemy and stopping them catching objectives. Now, that's wonderful, card, because it's not got a range restriction on it. So you can literally just throw a javelin at somebody if you wanted to, or blast them with a damage one starbolt, and you're giving them a movement token. Again, what you're doing then is you're stopping them moving onto objectives, you're stopping them coming towards you, slowing them down. Again, imagine that all you've got to do is just hit someone with any ranged attack, any attack at all, and you give, say, Moloch a move token, or you give Magor a move token, or whoever it might be, or Grimms, you know, one of the big orcs. They'd be upsetting, wouldn't it?
The same as the dart pipe that Otter
Pack. Exactly, the dart pipe. So you've got multiple opportunities to do it, so you could really shut people down. And also, the dart pipe only hits on crits, so this is your second chance to get it right if you have as well. And then I've got the Aetherism cards, or the Asterism cards, sorry, which is the Bulwark Celestial, the Great Drake, and Hunter's Speed, Hunter Steed, are all fantastic. They boost your entire warband. The Hunter Steed is my absolute go-to. I think I'd conclude that for definite. It's plus one move to your whole warband for a whole round. What? So all of a sudden your warband goes from movement 4 to 5 automatically. If they're not inspired, they're going to movement 6 if they are. Crazy. Scoring cover ground, and also letting you get all over the place really quickly. Bingo.
Superb. And some of the universal gambits that caught your eye as well.
Yeah, again, so the universal gambit ploys come in the box that anyone in the entire game can use. But let's have a look, see which ones are really good for the Starblood Stalkers. There's a card in here which I weighed so good, I imagine my prediction here will be that it'll be restricted early on. It's a card called Living Land. It's just a great card. It's a ploy. Pick one, right? Flip an objective token in the same number as the round, or move an objective token into your territory one hex. Wow. So you can flip an objective. If it's a turn number one, you flip objective token number one, turn number two, et cetera, et cetera. Wow. Okay. And that's got no range. If you're stood in your territory and objective one is miles away in the enemy territory, but it's turn one, you draw living land. Yeah, just flip that. It's no longer an objective token anymore. Great. Or move one objective token in your territory, a hex. So you can move it towards one of your guys to help you either capture it. So you could just move it under one of your fighters to help you inspire or score objectives, or move it to within the range of Kixi Taka's artifact, which is, it's a great card. It's so good for anyone who's trying to do anything with objectives. There's a card called Lost in Reflection also that comes with this expansion. Choose an enemy fighter from a warband with a primacy token, or pick an opponent. That opponent chooses one surviving fighter in the warband. Ultimately here, you'll be choosing an enemy fighter from a warband with a primacy token. The actual chances of you scoring the primacy token with this warband is tough. You've got to hold four objectives or kill a model that kill a model from scratch, from all wounds to no wounds, or kill an enemy leader. You're not going to be killing too many enemy leaders unless Clapdrop gets lucky. The chances are you're not going to be doing many big kills, and probably not going to be holding four objectives at any one time. So getting the primacy tokens can be tough. So any cards allow you to do that, wonderful, but also cards that penalize the opponent for having the primacy token, which they probably will because your skinks are squishy, are good. Yeah, that's it. So this fighter can, and also the chosen fighter. So you go, if the enemy's got the, if I'm playing you, Wade, and you've got the primacy token, and you've, I just choose one of your fighters, that chosen fighter cannot be activated in the next activation. It doesn't only last one activation, but that's, if that's, that could be the crucial charge or the crucial move. You just can't activate that fighter, which is great.
Layers of frustration.
Tell me. I love them. We've got a card called Pride Before a Fall, which also comes in the set as well. It's a reaction. Play during a friendly fighter's attack action after pushback. So basically, once you've hit someone and they've been pushed back, if the opponent has a primacy token, deals a damage to the target. So if you've got the primacy token, I'll deal another damage to you as you get pushed back, which is great because, again, you're going to have that token, chances are, and also boosts any of my attacks. Now, imagine that's Claptrox's attack going up to 4 damage straight away, or the Skink's doing 2 or 3 damage with their attacks. Wonderful. Very nice. If you want to do some killing, it's there.
Super.
And something these guys are going to try and do, one last card I've got here is one of my picks, is a guard called Outrun Death. Choose one fighter. That fighter is a quarry. It's fine. And has +2 move until the end of the round. +2 move. Again, the kick's attack is also good. But for Otal Paddle, who's already quarry, so he didn't get anything bad for that. But if you were to make kick's attack or a quarry, +2 move, puts him on movement 5, I think it is, or movement 6 even, he goes up to straight away. Well, that's great. Again, keep him out of danger if you possibly can.
Class. And what else from the wider game do you think will go well as a set of...
Yeah, there's a few ploys are all really available in the wider, again, these are cards from both Beastgrave and Diachasm. You've got the general push cards, which are great for moving your guys around and positioning. So Nightmare in the Shadows, Distraction, and Sidestep. Wonderful cards. We've got a card here called Unexpected Peril, which is a wonderful ploy. Choose a feature token in your territory, flip that token. Okay. I'll do that. There's a card called Leave Nothing to Chance. Pick a feature token on a hex containing a friendly fighter. Remove that hex, or remove that token, sorry. Great. You can see where this is going, right? Snare is a great card for deals extra damage for hunters after they've done a hit. So just like that Pride Before Fall card we talked about, does extra damage. Quite good if you want to try and kill someone. Not necessarily an auto-take, but it's there if you wanted to. You've got quite a few hunters in the warband. Beast Trail is one I spotted late last night that says choose one friendly hunter or quarry with no move or charge tokens on an edge hex. Let's say you deploy Otopaddle on an edge hex. Place that fighter in an edge hex with a movement token. Any edge hex. So it's amazing for Otopaddle to get in position so you can sort of blast people with this dart. That's him playing a flute. That's a blow dart. That's very different. So you can blast people with this dart pipe and shut people down straight away. What a card that is. He's zipping around all over the place. Also good as well. If you can make Kixi Taka a hunter or quarry in some way with various cards that allow you to do that sort of thing, then you can move him to the side of the battlefield to start zapping objectives with his artifact as well. Yeah, super frustrating. Again, the risk there is you get close to the enemy. So up to you.
Life is nothing without risk. This is why Star Masters have sent them in equipped with a Saurus Old Blood to afford a measure of protection. Right. Any number of cards allowing them to just disappear and reappear at various points on the board and stuff. And now what of the upgrades? How can you make these devilish fighters even more infuriating or hitting?
So upgrades are power cards that you pay glory to use. And once you've done that, you put that on that fighter's fighter card and they stay with that fighter for the rest of the game. So these are all pretty cool. Up first, we've got, I think, right, this is an ancient magic item from the world of Warhammer, the Cloak of Feathers. It's been in the game for a long time, hasn't it? As a magic item for Warhammer. This one is an upgrade that's restricted to Kick's attacker himself, but gives him +2 move and ignores blocked hexes when moving and lethal hexes. So he goes to movement 6 straight away and flies over blocked hexes and flies over all models. Wonderful card.
Fantastic.
He's all over the place. Heaven Blessed Weapons, another great upgrade for these guys. These are faction-specific ones, only available to this warband. +1 dice and knock back 1 to range 1 attack actions. Great. I've written here, turns Claptrop into a serious beast, and his chances of success with this attack goes from 75% to 87.5% to get success with his three dice smash attack that does three damage and now has knockback as well. Even the artwork even has a picture of him holding up his weapon looking really pleased with himself, which is quite cool. He likes killing stuff. If he's alive, I'm from turn two onwards. Great. I've got a card called Spawning Bond, which is also in the set as well, faction specific. Restricted to any skinks, so only Claptrop can't take it. Easy for you to say. It's a reaction after other friendly skinks is pushed from a hex within three hex. After a friendly skink is pushed from a hex within three hexes, pushes fighter a hex. So basically, they're pushed from, say, Skittish, great, or any of your push cards, you get to move a hex as well. You get to move two guys with Skittish, basically. And I've said here, this is great to give both Otapattle and Kick the Attacker the Skittish rule as well for one turn only, which is quite cool. So I've got another card called Supreme Predator, which helps Claptrop become an absolute combat beast, turns him into a hunter and helps him hit quarries, which is great. Unhesitating is another card which helps you give plus two move to all your skinks. Amazing. You can put your Kick the Attacker up to movement nine if you get all the combos right. There's another couple of universal upgrades in the expansion as well, which are great for everybody in the game, but specifically for these guys. Labyrinth Boots lets you move your fighter to the lowest number objective on the board. So if there's any objective one there, you get to move into it. So you're just moving your guys around all over the place onto objective tokens. You want to get that in your deck for definite. Proud Runner is also in this set. It's not great, gives you plus one move. And if you make move of five or more, you gain the primacy token. Well, that's great because you want to get that primacy token off people because there's a very other chance you're going to be able to do that. And of course, everyone's making a move of five or more if they get plus one move, apart from the Saurus. So that's quite an easy one to do with the skinks as well. I'd say probably an auto take on.
You can definitely get the Saurus inspired easily enough, as we've already discussed. And if you've got your preferred Asterism running, does he get an extra point of move as well there?
Yes, indeed. And if he gets that one, with inspired and Asterism, the Hunter's Steed and the Proud Run, he gets up to movement six, which is terrifying when you're dishing out three damage, maybe four, with the jaws. There's also as always, there are some upgrades in here that are great for everybody that I would use. Sorry, for the Starblock Stalkers. So from the wider game, definitely get great speed in there because it's always good. That's plus one movement. Lethal Snares: when a fighter ends a push or move on a feature token or placed in that feature token, flip the feature token. Great, end your move. For an upgrade, he just flips that feature token automatically. Wonderful. Savage Speed gives you plus two move, but minus one defense to a minimum of one. Well, that's not a problem because Kixi Tagger only ever has a one defense dice. So all of a sudden, he could be going to movement 11. Savage Strength is another card, which is great. If your fighter is a hunter, plus one damage on range one and two weapons, but minus one defense. I say put this on Huachi the Skink, makes him damage three attacks with no downside. And you can compare that with Snare to make him damage four attacks, which is a wonderful combo. And there's one last card I found last night, which is Geomancer's Gauntlet. It's an action flip each feature token within a hex. Yes, auto take. Think of that speedy skink running around, just landing on things, splitting those tokens all over. It's wonderful.
Superb. So that's a fine in-depth analysis of what is available to the Starblood Stalkers warband themselves within the box and elsewhere outside in the wider Warhammer Underworlds game. But as we know from these expansions, there are new things in the expansion, new cards for every warband to make use of. And we know, Nick Bayton, you love every Warhammer Underworlds warband.
All of them equally. Apart from those corner ones, I don't like those.
What features or what cards from this new set would you be looking to introduce to some of your other warbands or games?
Well, we've already got a few I've mentioned already, Wade. Living Land is the one where you flip an objective token the same number as the round. Wonderful stuff. Get that in your Khagra's Ravagers or Hrothgon's Mantrappers decks when you're trying to get rid of objectives. That's great. Predatory Form is a quite cool. It's a gambit spell. Costs one focus to cast. The caster becomes a hunter and attack actions have ensnare. This is great for aggressive wizards who use stuff like Vortimus from the Eyes of the Nine, Stormsire, Fecula from the Wormspat. And the best use I can think of for this is Thedra from the Godsworn Hunt, who when inspired will have damage three attacks with ensnare, which is dastardly. There's another great upgrade in this pack called Eagle Eye, which is an upgrade, and if the fighter becomes a hunter, and you can re-roll one attack dice in this fighter's attack roll for range three attack actions. Crucially, that's not wizards, because wizards use magic dice, not attack dice. But if you're using Thunderous Profiteers, in it goes, because there's lots of guys who've got range, the pistols and the big guns. Also great for Alfheim from Scarce Wild Hunt and Sanella from Myra's Purifiers in particular, because you get to reroll with the lob shot from the bow as well. And also, pro tip, it will be amazing on the upcoming Storm of Celestis fighters from the starter set, which we can't say too much about, but they've all looks like they've got big bows, right?
When I was to the Void Sphere, I didn't like the look of the Void Sphere, just for my proclivities for cornate things and just the idea of shutting things down and also doing damage. It's a good time.
Yeah, man, that's a good card, that one. Labyrinth Boots and Proud Runner, we talked about as well, are just good for all different cards. Proud Runner, especially on Spikeclaw Swarm. Anyone that's movement 4, Wild Hunt, Despoilers, Lady Harrow's Mournflight, anyone that's got primary movement 4 fighters on their Proud Runner, get +1 move. So if you move 5 on week in the primacy token, good stuff, that is.
I do love the art of Colossal Fist.
That's interesting, isn't it? Colossal Fist is a magic attack action, was an upgrade, but it's only range 1, which means your wizard has to be in close combat with an opponent fighter, which is fine for some wizards, not fine for others. You wouldn't put this on Vortimus, but Stormside's already got a damage to attack with his staff. So you're looking to find wizards in the game that haven't got a damage to attack that want to be close, and I think that's quite a very niche. But it's a wicked bit of art. I do like that.
It would be of interest to somebody, certainly. So with everything that you've processed and digested so far, how do you think the Starblood Stalkers are going to fare against the other warbands? Who do you think they might excel against, and who do you think they might struggle against?
From all we've talked about, I think my prediction here is that they'll be quite good against slow-moving, aggressive warbands who struggle to get to them. So Morgox Crushers, Steelheart's Champions, lesser Morgor's Fiends because of Riptooth, but to a certain extent them. They'll just be able to run around and keep them away and stop them hitting them, in theory. But at the same time, if they get to them, they're in real trouble. Molog is in real trouble as well. They'll just zap him and stop him and shut him down. All those different ways you've got to either stop him moving or stop him doing anything at all. Wonderful. I think they'll do super well against any warbands trying to use objective to gain glory. So if you're the Grimwatch, your Zarbax Gits, or your Sepulchral Guard players who are trying to score glory from holding objective tokens, and you are just taking those objective tokens off the table, they're in real trouble, especially because they're quite easy to kill too. But I don't think they're going to do so well against super fast, aggressive warbands who are right up in their face quickly, like Ripper Snarlfang, Scarcewell Hunt, Lady Harris Mournflight, who I think are going to be all over them fast. And I think particularly their worst matchup, I think, would be Thorns of the Briar Queen, who can equal their maneuverability, hold all the objectives, and kill them dead early on as well with the Briar Queen. So yeah, it's a bit of a sort of like paper, scissors, stone with Underworld sometimes. If you come up against the wrong warband, and you might be in trouble, and watch out for the Thorns. They're powerful anyway, but especially against these guys.
It's interesting, considering what we talked about a few weeks ago for the Warhammer Underworlds, the Warhammer Community podcast, about Kangra's Ravages and their desecration dynamic or mechanic, and how that introduced something new to the game that people have to be aware of. This feels like an interesting counterpoint to that, another objective adjacent warband that can do things to objectives that other warbands haven't necessarily been able to do in that quantity before. An interesting counterpoint. It's interesting that the old ones have sent balance in the form of the Starblood Stalkers to deal with the damage being wrought by Kangra's Ravages.
It's quite cool. We definitely saw as well. It's interesting as well. It's like, as a game design mechanic way, this is a very anti-objective warband. They're holding their own objectives, but they're destroying yours. It's interesting that it's definitely become a rock to their scissors, if it makes sense. You know, it's a nice warband to put into the game system, because objective holding warbands are going to have to know that exists out there now, and they're going to have to do something about it. I imagine that objective warbands might put a few killie cards in there, or speed increase cards to get into Kixi Taka and kill him early on if they possibly can. It's definitely going to be a tough one to counter.
And as we know, you get to put together the wonderful assembly and painting videos for the number of Warhammer Underworlds warbands that are released. So I think by the time this podcast is out in the world, people will indeed have their own warbands, and they'll be shuffling through their own cards and maybe even painting their own warbands. Awesome. Will you be painting another set for yourself as part of your painting every Underworlds warband? How are you thinking of doing them?
Absolutely, I will, Wade, yes. Yeah, you're absolutely right. I made a painting video for these guys, which is quite cool. We showed you how to paint Kick's Attack all the way through. We showed you how to paint Otapattle skin and Clacktrock shield. So hopefully with all of that stuff, you should be able to paint the whole warband. I will indeed be painting my own up. I haven't decided on a color scheme for those guys yet. I imagine they'll be blue in some description. I like painting things blue and gold, and Seraphon are blue and gold. So that works for me, right?
As mentioned, you got that lovely Seraphon Warcry warband converted from the Lizardmen Blood Bowl team, and you stuck to the classic Lizardmen as was colours that we see these Seraphon in. But I'm conscious that these are not Lizardmen. These are Seraphon, and people paint their own warbands in all sorts of different colours and add their own character to them. So I'll be interested to see if people do coalesced or starborn versions of these Seraphon and do them from different realms or different colours. But they do look very good in that blue and gold turquoise plastic, even before they're painted, but painted up in blue, gold and turquoise. They look very well.
I love seeing them in, like, when you see people do colour schemes that sort of like reflect real life, like jungle animals. So I've seen like the poisonous tree frog Seraphon, which looks fantastic. Or, you know, or like weird snake skin Seraphon, or like wonderful stuff. Yeah, I might go down that route. I don't know. But I might need to paint something that's not blue and gold. Maybe even, Wade, we were talking the other day that when the Seraphon, previously were known as Lizardmen in Warhammer, first came out, they were sort of crocodilian green. Quite cool, isn't it? So who knows? Lots of different things you could paint them.
Great times. Well, we'll check in on you, I'm sure, and see how your various Warhammer Underworlds warbands are progressing. And whenever the next one comes out, whenever that may be, I hope we get to talk about that as well and see what that introduces to the gaming landscape. Well, thank you for your time and your deep dive into the Starblood Stalkers, Nick. It's been an absolute delight.
Thank you very much indeed. Yeah, it was good fun to spend such a long time studying Skinks and Saurus. I feel like I slammed myself.
Well, I'm sure you're going to be well-versed when it comes to the gaming with this warband. Hopefully anyone listening to this feels like they've learned something too. Thank you very much for joining us for this episode of the Warhammer Community Podcast. We'll see you again soon.